I don't know if it's changed since the Occupy movement, but the Occupy movement certainly pointed up the importance of having access to public space. We were just having a conversation in the conference about an idea of public space that's too uniform, an urban design idea that essentially thinks of public space as a series of pleasant open places in which people can gather. And one of the arguments that I would make is that it's important not to think about public space in this homogeneous way, but to think of it as a space or a series of spaces that serves not a single public, but multiple publics. Because skateboarding kids and elderly people and people who are looking to gather for demonstrations look on public space in very different ways. So we have to begin to think about public space not simply in ways that accommodate a series of uses that we're aware of, but as a set of spaces out of which future uses that are not yet imagined can be extracted. So public space is not an entity so much, it's not a physical thing, so much as it is a series of negotiations in which private and public interests contend, public space is contested, in order to exercise their separate forms of rights in and to the city. If by inclusive approaches you mean approaches in which a wide variety of stakeholders are consulted about the development of cities, I would say that they're just beginning to have a public that's able to intervene. In fact, as you well know, China is very centralized. It's still highly authoritarian. There's lots of corruption. On the other hand, China is the scene of tremendous energy and action. You know, it's urbanizing at a completely exponential rate. Hundreds of millions of people are leaving poverty and entering the middle class, and the vast majority of these people are also migrating from the countryside into the city. So the pressures of urbanization in China are like nowhere in the world, and that by definition makes it an interesting place to be an urbanist. I could also say about China that there is a rising consciousness of questions about sustainable urbanism. In large measure, there's more talk than action, but we've designed a number of cities in China, and we've designed them to very high standards in terms of the environment, in terms of a mix of uses and people, in terms of a structure predicated on neighborhoods. So I feel that I have not been obliged to betray any fundamental principle in the design. Of course, in China, architects very quickly lose control of projects. So what these ideas will be translated into, I'm not sure. But there's a strong growing environmental movement in China. You know, they're at the crisis point in terms of the toxicity of the air, in terms of the unsustainable planning practices, in terms of absolutely desperate shortages of water. So you know, people are conscious. And as I say, they're talking the talk. It remains to be seen whether they're going to seriously walk the walk. Another qualifier, there's tremendous amount of construction activity in China, and you know, more miles of subways and public transportation systems have been built in China in the last week than the United States has built in the last 100 years. So this has to be seen as something of a positive. You know, on the other hand, it's a society that's highly committed to the automobile, to private ownership, and that's something that's also increasing exponentially. So they're struggling to come to terms with the level of their crisis, with the nature of governance, with how much democracy is going to be permitted, with their architectural heritage, and also with a set of planning practices that were essentially inherited from Soviet models, which are very out of date. So much of Chinese urban construction is single-use, super-block, car-dependent, jobs 100 kilometers away. But the conversation is going on there. And I'm cautiously, I wouldn't say optimistic, but cautiously hopeful that some transformation will be achieved in China. And I think it's everybody's responsibility because, you know, questions of pollution and overpopulation and scarce resources, those concern all of us around the world. China has become a new imperialist nation. Their vast holdings in natural resources and agricultural land in Africa, for example, make the solution of the Chinese problem a question for the entire planet. So unless we can collectively, as a species, not as a series of nation states, come up with some rational ideas about appropriation and sharing of resources, China fails, and so do the rest of us. This is such a kind of portmanteau. How would I define this shared city? There's been a lot of conversation about the so-called right to the city. And I guess I would say that the shared city is the city in which each citizen is able to freely exercise his or her rights. I construe this very broadly. A lot of people think of the right to the city as being primarily a question of access. Certainly the opportunity to freely walk in any part of the city is part of the shared city. But so too, for example, I would say is the opportunity to live in any part of the city. So in New York, for example, our income gap becomes an obscenity. Segregated geographies, not simply based on race, but on class and income, are getting worse and worse. And this is, this is the antithesis in my mind of the shared city. But this idea of the right to the city, which I think has been discussed fairly extensively in the conference and descends, as a term of art from a French philosopher called Henri Lefebvre, who wrote a book called The Right to the City in 1968, I guess, great year, includes not simply these matters of kind of physical accessibility, but the right to imagine the kind of city in which one would want to live. So this private and collective operation of imagination, of envisioning, of thinking about how the city might be transformed in ways that are conducive to happiness and security, I think this is a very vital element of any notion of the shared city.